Israel celebrates 33 years of independence. A nation born in conflict is now the dominant military power in the Middle East. Fourteen summers ago, in the Six-Day War of June 1967, the Jews again defeated their Arab enemies. The Israeli flag flew over new territories. And Israel controlled a new resource, the waters of the West Bank. The West Bank is the most important of the territories captured in 1967. The Judean hills provide Israel with security and with water. Beneath their barren surface, the winter rains collect. When the rainwater reaches rock layers it can't penetrate, it forms underground reservoirs, aquifers, some emerging from the ground as springs and rivers. For centuries, these natural water sources have been the life stream of the West Bank. For 700,000 Palestinian Arabs, and now for 20,000 new Jewish settlers, there's always the question, whose hand on the tap?
It's important to know where your water is coming from. Important to know you have water. In an area like this, which is the Jordan Rift, in the Jordan Rift Valley, where temperatures reach 100 degrees Fahrenheit and more during the summer, without water you can't live here.
The new arrivals have transformed the West Bank's landscape. They need guaranteed supplies of water. So for its settlers, the Israeli government has drilled wells to the depth of 2,000 feet, costing up to £1 million each. The new settlers believe they have a holy mission. Any idea of the land or its water resources being returned to Palestinian hands is unthinkable.
If they control here, they control everything. There is no question of giving water into the hands and not giving other things into the hands. And control here should be only in Jewish hands.
In the Middle East, water is scarce. Its control is vital. Overpumping can ruin the underground reservoirs. In the West Bank, the Israelis have found water in the desert where no Arabs have ever drilled before. But they warn the Arabs that any future attempt to compete in the search for water would not be tolerated.
We know one thing for sure, that a competition between the two societies on water resources will bring to one result. The total destruction of the resources that could be the resource for survival for the two societies.
Israel makes sure that no such competition takes place. This rig is primitive by Israeli standards. It's drilling one of the handful of new wells for Arab farmers that the Israeli military government has licensed since 1967. For 14 years, Arab farmers' use of water has been effectively frozen by the West Bank Water Department's withholding of drilling licenses.
Why is it that Israeli settlements are allowed to drill for water when Arab farmers have not been allowed to drill for water since 1967, in almost every case?
Well, first of all, I'm not authorized, or the water department is not authorized to issue new licenses. This is a policy of the government of Israel that licenses will be given, or the licenses will be given by us, but only when and if the water commissioner will approve any petition.
So this is a political decision that is taken?
This is a political decision, and We got it as it is.
Israel captured the West Bank from Jordan in 1967. Since then, between the central mountain ridge and the Jordan River, the Israelis have drilled some 24 wells, nearly all to a deep aquifer never previously tapped. Israel regards this aquifer as new water for it to dispose of.
There are now Jewish settlements there who utilize the deep aquifer only without, in fact, any influence on the other water sources. From this specific place, the government has the right to decide to whom they are going to give the additional unutilized water.
But they only give it to Jewish settlements, not to Arab farmers.
As a matter of fact, you are right.
But is it fair that Arabs shouldn't be allowed to use that water?
It has nothing to do with justice or injustice, because it doesn't hurt any Arab individual. Any. Everybody has his water rights as he had before, or better. It might be much better. It is not much better, but it's still either the same or better. The rest of the water, the unutilized water, I do believe that the government, whoever it is, has the right to decide what to do with it. If there will be somewhere in future another government, I'm sure they will have another priorities for this water, not for the Jewish settlements.
But the government that is in power at the moment is not an elected government, as far as the Arabs are concerned. It's an imposed government.
Yes.
And that imposed government has told them you can have no more water in the Jordan Valley for agriculture.
For the time being, that's the facts.
In the West Bank, the military governor's water department is staffed by Arabs. They record the flow of water in the West Bank's springs and rivers. And they check the water level of all Arab wells to guard against overpumping. They must help implement an Israeli drilling policy of which they strongly disapprove.
With the water.
For it's the Arab staff who find themselves telling Arab farmers that they have no hope of being allowed to drill new wells for irrigation.
Those farmers who come to you must know that new wells have been drilled for Jewish settlements.
Not know, they see it.
So
they see the drilling rigs and wells being used and water coming out and land being cultivated. So they see this.
So how do they feel? What do they say when you tell them that they have no chance of getting a permit for their wells?
Well, what do you expect them to do, you know? Or how to feel? Really, they feel bitter about it.
The Jewish settlements in the Jordan Valley were originally established purely as a defense line. Now they flourish, with water denied to Arab farmers and often on land Arabs used to cultivate. The settlements are heavily subsidized by Israel, not least in the price of water. In an area where the water pumped for all Arab farmers is limited to an annual 26 million cubic meters, the amount used by Jewish settlements is increasing rapidly.
When do you think the point in time will come when the Israeli wells are pumping more than the Arab wells?
They already, in fact, now they are taking more. In 80, 81, as I understood, they are pumping now about 27 million, which is more than the pumpage by the Arabs.
It's impossible to confirm those figures. Statistics for the amount pumped by the Israeli wells have not been published since 1979. They're a military secret, making official denials hard to challenge.
How much water at the moment is being pumped by those wells?
The exact quantity is 17 million. So you should put the question in its proportion.
Which year was this? 17 million.
Last year.
It was 17 million in 1978, 1979, and there's been six new wells drilled since then.
It is still 17 million. Once you drill new wells, you don't extract extra water.
I've been told it's 27 million.
I'm sorry.
There's no mystery about Arab water consumption. In 1976, meters were placed on every well and tap, and quotas limited the water that could be used. For Arabs, it was a sharp reminder of how tightly Israel could control their water supply, though Israel denies any such intention.
There is no case in the whole West Bank that any Arab farmer or anybody who used to use water before, no one took any drop of water from him.
How real is this fear of an Israeli hand on the tap?
Actually, it's not a fear, it's a fact. It's not a fear, it's not something to look for a future, it's a fact. When you limit the quantities of water that should be pumped, so that's it, you know. It's not something to for the future, it is from yesterday. Since the licenses for extracting water were issued, this was it.
It's been said to us that no Arab has actually lost any water rights since 1967 as a result of the Israeli occupation.
As a statement, this is true, that since 60, all those who were in 67 and they owned wells, they didn't lose anything. But certainly you can't stop life, you know, and stop time at 67 and say that's it, you know, for the Arabs, you know, for the people living here. And actually this is what happened. That since 67, no more drilling, no more development, no more nothing. We stopped at this point. Those who had wells in 67, they still have them, but nothing new.
Much of Palestinian agriculture has been unchanged for decades. The rituals of olive growing long predate Israel's occupation of the West Bank. The olive trees are deep-rooted, hardy enough to survive the rainless months. For olive farmers, there's little need for water for irrigation, even if they could afford it. A third of the West Bank's cultivated land is devoted to olive groves. But it's in the valleys between the terraced hills of olives that the West Bank's agriculture really thirsts for water. In these valleys, irrigation could transform the economy. Without irrigation, only one crop a year can be grown, such as wheat or barley, dependent on the winter rain. With irrigation, two crops a year of much more valuable vegetables or fruit could be cultivated. The potential for agricultural expansion is immense. In the West Bank, only 4% of the farmland is irrigated. In Israel, the figure is 50%. There are water restrictions on both sides of the border, but their effects are profoundly unequal. Under Israeli rule, West Bank farmers have slowly raised their income, but within Israeli limits. Their exports to the Israeli market are strictly controlled. Israeli farmers have free access to the West Bank market. So the main route for West Bank farm exports is across the Jordan River bridges into neighboring Arab countries. An unpredictable outlet. West Bank agriculture feels itself constrained by unfair competition, by land expropriations, by water restrictions, and Israel is blamed.
You see, you have to understand that the West Bank economy is primarily agricultural at this point, not so the Israeli economy. Agriculture is the main source of livelihood for people. They need the water, they need the land in order just to live and to continue to exist. If these basic resources are taken away from the Palestinians, they will have very little left.
Palestinian farming has survived at the expense of its labor force, reduced by a third since 1967, with no jobs to go to on the West Bank. The surplus workers have joined the exodus to Israel of 30,000 unskilled labourers bussed across the old border, the invisible green line, every day. Leaving at dawn, returning 12 hours later. That Arab farmers suffer from water restrictions has not affected Israeli policy. But international criticism at least appears to have persuaded the government it should stop giving its own settlers preferential treatment.
We are now constructing a pipeline from the Lake of Galilee, which is totally our resource, downwards to Jericho in order to supply our settlements with what we call our share of the total water balance. So we will not, in a very short time, and it's a question of a duration of a year or two, that we shall not be, you will not be able to blame us for using water that should have been used by the local farmers for their purposes, for their development, in order to develop our settlements.
Israel already transports water from the Lake of Galilee 80 miles to the Negev Desert by canal and pipeline. It'll be a major undertaking to extend this to the West Bank, but without water from somewhere, how can new Israeli farms grow?
Will there be any new Jewish agricultural settlements on the West Bank?
I think yes, but I have answered before, with one restriction. The water supply for Jewish settlement in the Western Bank will be on what I'll put in very simple terms on our account.
Only with water from Galilee?
That's right.
But on whose account will be the water at the West Bank settlement of Shiloh? Official policy is no new water for Jewish agriculture, except from inside Israel, inside the Green Line. Yet at Shiloh, they still search for water under the West Bank itself. A new well has been drilled and is about to be tested. For 3 years, the settlers have had to rely on tanker deliveries, even for drinking water. Now, first results from the new well indicate so much water that the Shiloh settlers hope to use it to irrigate up to 20,000 dunums of land, 5,000 acres.
For drinking purposes, it's obviously too much, but thank God we have plenty of land in the area which would not be able to use agriculture on these lands because of the fact that we have no water. Once we have the water, these lands which are not being used now will become a very great source of income to the people here.
So how many dunums in all would you expect to be able to irrigate?
Close to 10,000.
10,000
in the future, if the water suffices.
With the
and
water
if we can purchase more land, then obviously even more. The valley beneath us is over 10,000 itself, and if we could purchase some of that land, then we have no problem.
The land that Shiloh wants is farmed by Arabs. But so little of the West Bank's land is officially registered that settlements find it easy to expand. The question is, will the government allow Shiloh to use the new water for agriculture?
The settlers there told us that they were planning to use some of that water to irrigate between 10 and 20,000 dunums of land for agriculture.
And you got it from the settlers there in Shiloh? Yeah. They are planning to irrigate some 20,000 dunums?
That's right.
I don't know, but I'm sure not in Shiloh.
If they ask for permission to use the water for agriculture, do you think they'll get permission?
I believe so, but not from us, from the water commissioner.
I don't know the results of the drilling the well at Shiloh. I don't know if they will ask for permission for water use for agricultural purposes. I know one thing, we shall not, and we intend to do it, we shall not treat Israeli settlers for agricultural purposes in other means than Arabic farmers.
Shiloh will be a test of the Water Commissioner's sincerity, for 2 miles north of the settlement is the valley of Sawiya, a dry farming area where Arabs have no hope of being allowed water for irrigation. To lose land to Shiloh would be bad enough. To watch it being irrigated with the West Bank's water would be worse. The Farah River is another test of Israeli intentions. There, the biggest Arab irrigation scheme on the West Bank has awaited official approval for 3 years. The river's channeled in open irrigation canals. Water evaporates and is lost. Enclosing the canals would save water, and paid for by foreign aid, cost Israel nothing. But there's still no approval. The Arabs see the green line, the old border, as the boundary of prosperity, and they're on the wrong side.
There is no extra water being used for agriculture in the West Bank now.
Except in one respect, there is no extra water used for agriculture inside the Green Line since 1967. Exactly parallel with what's happening in the Western Bank.
But are there any areas of Israel which need water for irrigation in the same way that the dry farming areas of the West Bank do?
So what is your offer? Let me answer your question with a question. What is your offer? Your offer means cancelling Israeli agriculture inside the Green Line, Israeli settlements inside the Green Line, in order to make it able to Arabs outside the Green Line to construct new agriculture. So cancelling agriculture that exists for 20 years in order to create new agriculture by another nation. Is that an answer?
Is that the only alternative?
This is the only alternative.
In the Jordan Valley, a line of Arab wells stands abandoned. Across the river from some of the most fertile land in Jordan, Israel has cleared thousands of acres of cultivated fields as a security strip. It was Israeli technology, energy, and idealism which made the Negev desert bloom. Near Jericho, in the Jordan Valley, Israeli soldiers and settlers play noisily, unaware of the resentment they arouse. Their swimming pool is in fact part of the irrigation system for the Arab village of Oja, bringing the waters of the Oja spring to the drinking taps and fields of the farmers. At Oja, water rights are handed down from father to son. Each farm has its inherited share of the river's flow. It's a system that's generations old. In 1970, a Jewish settlement was established near the village.
They came to what we call in Arabic the Mukhtars, and they said to them, we have a settlement here, and we are brothers, Jewish and Arabs, and we want to drink water. And so let's take some water, a small pipe of water from the spring, and to let the Jewish drink. So of course, our Mukhtars agreed.
It was a temporary arrangement. Soon afterwards, the Israeli state water company, Makarot, drilled the first of its wells to serve the Jewish settlers, right next to the Oja spring.
After the drilling of the wells, each year in summer, there had been a reduction in the quantity of water of the spring, but it reached the top when the whole spring was in drought. The water is finished.
For a river which normally flows so freely to disappear was a major disaster. For the cause, Oja's farmers looked no further than the pipes and wells constructed by the Israeli water company, Makarot. A connection firmly rejected by Israel.
Do you believe that the Oja spring was affected by the Israeli wells drilled nearby?
Absolutely no. For sure no. Hydrologically, it cannot be affected, I mean geohydrologically, because the wells are downstream, in a place to a different, first of all, to a different water zone, what we called aquifer, and the difference in elevation between the spring itself and the water table in these wells is so different that cannot be any connection between them.
The Israelis argue that the Oges spring is fed by an aquifer close to the surface, whereas their settlers use a different aquifer, hundreds of meters deeper. So the Makarot wells could not have dried the spring. But was that the end of Israel's responsibility to Oger?
Well, if the Arab farmers there see that they don't have water to irrigate their groves, vegetable and so on, and their neighbors who take from another source, I mean the neighbors, the Israeli settlements, take straight from a different aquifer, an aquifer that was never used by the local people, but it's in their vicinity and they see it, there is a problem, a human problem, there is, of course.
During this period that the Oger farmers had no water for their fields, the Israeli settlements nearby had as much water as they needed.
I believe so.
How did you feel about that, in charge of water for the West Bank?
I wasn't happy.
Was there anything you could do?
We couldn't force Mekorot. I mean, I couldn't force Mekorot to supply with water to the farmers. We tried and we failed.
Did they give you a reason?
They said that they don't have enough water for themselves. In spite of the fact that they have some nice wells and they were pumping a lot, but they had a certain schedule to fill for all the settlements.
At Oger, the only water supplied by the authorities during the drought was for drinking. The fields were left to die. Further north from Oger in the Jordan Valley is the Arab village of Bardala. Bardala has never been rich, but the Israeli occupation has brought extra hardship.
هذا البيت تبعنا مؤسسة أساسا يشتبش للقبل 67 كان ضخمة يسكي جميع الأراضي اللي واقعة شرقي النهر حوالي 5000 دلم كان يسكيه البير هذا نفسه بير بردلة هذا الموجود حاليا.
He says that this well, the village well of Bardala, was drilled before 1967. It was drilled in 1965. In 1968, the Israelis drilled another well, a few meters up, next to this village well, and gradually it dried up their well.
The village well is now abandoned. The Israeli drilling upstream predictably dried both Bardala's water and the springs at the neighboring village of Ein El Beda.
It was so obvious, really, that if you drill, you know, upstream, you know, from the wells and springs in Bardala and Ain El Beda, that there will be effect. There was no doubt about it, nothing to predict in advance, you know. It's a known fact, really.
The well which dried out Bardala was drilled to serve the Israeli settlement of Mahola. While Mahola thrived, the West Bank's water officer tried to persuade Israel to help Bardala. After 7 years, the water officer won the argument. But of the original decision to drill upstream from Bardala, he has little to say.
There wasn't the question that time, what is my opinion about it? When I came there, it was a fact. And after this was a fact, we have to look for a solution. A solution, a just solution for the people, and we found it. It wasn't easy.
But what was your opinion of the fact?
Well, why should we talk about opinions? Yeah, the fact was that time this. This was the fact.
The solution found for Bardala was to drill another well, the only well drilled for Arab farmers by Israel since 1967. The two systems now operate side by side, one for the Arabs, one for the Jews, though both controlled by Israel.
إذا هم اشتغلوا بحاجة لماء بيعطوا لماء، مش بحاجة ما بيعطوا لماء من مرة. إذا حياتنا مهددة بالخطر.
Recently, the Israelis have agreed to compensate them for the loss of water. But now he says we are at the mercy of the Israelis. Whenever they are pumping, we have water. If they are not pumping, we don't have water. He says from owners of this resource, we are now becoming renters from the Israelis.
At least Bardala has its water back, 85% of it anyway. Of Bardala's farmers, 15% are classified as absentees. Under Israeli occupation, absentees can lose their land and water rights. Refugees are the chief victims of the Middle East's wars, uprooted by the 100,000. From Israel in 1948, from the West Bank in 1967. For those who never returned, Israel has appointed a custodian of absentee property, Israel.
By what right can Israel take away from the farmers of Bardala the water that should have gone to those absentees?
To whom do you think it should have gone, the water from the absentees?
The villagers of Bardala.
To the absentees. But they are absent. So the water has to be utilized by somebody, can be utilized, and I think that the one who is in charge of everything that has all the property that used to be before to belong to the absentees, he has the right to decide what to do with them.
By what right can the Israeli authorities take away water because some people are absentees?
Well, this is the by right of occupation, actually. Because they occupied this area, and so that's it, you know, they do whatever they want.
It's not just West Bank farmers who complain of Israel's water policies. The towns have their problems too. The most prominent Palestinian opponent of Israel's occupation has been the mayor of Nablus, Bassam Shaka. His outspoken conflicts with Israel, especially over water rights, have made him a target for attack. Last year, both his legs were blown off by a car bomb. The shattered wreck still stands outside his house. No one doubts it was Jewish terrorists who maimed him. But after 12 months, there have been no arrests, no charges. Shaka has survived his injuries, and he has not lost his voice.
The military governor look for the water for their aims, not for our aims. And as you know, they control the water in our land, in the West Bank and Gaza, and they control the policy of the water because they want to keep the water for their farmers and the settlements. For that, they forbidden us to drill the wells which we need and which we like.
Nablus, like the other main Arab towns, lies on the West Bank's central mountain ridge. On each side, there's an aquifer. But the aquifer to the west is shared with Israel. Arab drilling is forbidden. Only in the aquifer to its east has Nablus been allowed to drill for drinking water.
They give us permission to drill a well far than Nablus and deep in the Jordan Valley. And it's far about 14 kilometers. For that, the water which we bring it to Nablus, it's be very expensive.
A new well is being drilled for Nablus in the eastern aquifer under Israeli supervision. Zev Golani is no longer water officer for the West Bank, but he still acts as a consultant in the area. Golani believes that the new well can save Nablus money despite its distance from the town. He argues that it makes sense to link up with another well in the eastern aquifer that Israel drilled for Nablus, also without the town's consent and against its wishes.
we encourage them to drill another well in the vicinity because they have already the infrastructures to this direction to take the water. They have the main line, they have the electrical line over there, and it comes out cheaper for them to utilize the second one there and to send the water to Nablus.
But they want to drill wells on the other side of Nablus.
It is right. I know that they ask to drill wells in the other side, but what they need is water. They don't need wells that are taking water from this limited aquifer that is already fully utilized by the Israelis.
The fully utilized aquifer is the Western aquifer, from which Israel diverts Arab drilling by arguing that there is still water unused to the east. Water which flows out into the Dead Sea and is wasted unless intercepted before becoming too salty to use.
The mayor of Nablus says he's only been allowed a well to the east of Nablus, not to the west.
That's right, because east of Nablus, water that is not being extracted is getting lost to the Dead Sea. So why not using first water that is getting lost and starting the use of water that somebody else might use it?
But he says that it's
what harm do we cause to Nablus if we supply Nablus with water, with fresh water and good water, that is getting lost now? Why demanding only water which can be used by somebody else, either Arabs or Jews? Why not using first the water that is getting lost?
Because it's more expensive to bring water from further east than from
who
the west.
Who told you?
He thinks.
I do not accept what he thinks. I do not accept what he thinks. But in a place or in an area where water scarcity is the major problem, I don't understand the question.
But Nablus understands the answer. The Arabs know that it's intensive Israeli pumping on their side of the Green Line which causes water scarcity in the Western aquifer. Israel takes 95% of that aquifer's water and, paradoxically, gives some of it back in a way that only makes the Arabs feel more vulnerable. In the town of Ramallah, as in the West Bank generally, domestic use of water has doubled since 1967. But Ramallah is unique. Half its water supply is actually piped from inside Israel. Arab consumers may be glad to be connected to the mains, but Ramallah fears Israeli control through its dependence on the Israeli pipeline. The town claims it was only persuaded to take water from Israel because of the lengthy delays in the authorizing and drilling of its own new well.
We claim for a new well to the Israeli authorities or the occupying authorities to drill a new well in 1972. We got an answer, and I can say it, a negative answer from them, conditioned to connect our water with the Israeli line and to be under their mercy. So now anytime the Israelis, they can stop all the water from our people here in Ramallah district.
Are you sure in your own mind that you would not have got permission to drill that well if you had not accepted the Israeli water?
Yes, my friend, I'm sure of that.
Ramallah now has its new well, though no water is flowing from it as yet. Any suggestion that permission to drill was conditional upon accepting Israeli water is strongly denied by Israel. All they did, say the Israelis, was to build a reservoir and pipeline, lay on a supply of water to Ramallah's doorstep, and then wait for water shortages to exert their own pressure on a reluctant town.
It was summertime. There was lack of water, and I had to do something in order to bring the water to the other side and to distribute the water between the customers.
So what did you do?
I used to telephone him twice a day. No. I'm not the one to create political pressure. It is not my job. So I don't know about any political pressure which was put on Ramallah.
Why do you not want to accept Israeli water?
Because, as you know, we don't want to be under their mercy. Perhaps our students or our people make a demonstration against the occupation. We will be under their mercy. They can stop supporting us by water.
Ramallah already has experience of Israel's control. The Jewish settlement of Ofra was built across the main pipeline leading to the town. When Ramallah refused to supply Ofra with water, the Israelis helped themselves.
The Ofra settlement, in spite of our decision not to give them water, and without asking us, they broke the pipes and they connect the water to settlers by force. When we went and we told the military governor, why you are doing such things, which is against the law, he said, and he told me and my colleagues that it is by power. When you get the power, you can do anything you want.
Ramallah feels Israel's hand not just on its tap and well and pipeline, but on its main reservoir too. It's built into the hill overlooking the town, and Israel has chosen to site an army camp on the same hill. The technician who comes to check the reservoir's level twice a day needs a military pass to do so. Having its main reservoir declared a security zone only adds to Ramallah's sense of insecurity. Ramallah's new well may soon rid it of the need for Israel's water. But Ramallah will still feel under pressure if Ofra stays and if the army camp stays.
One of the reasons why the people of Ramallah fear Israeli control of their water supply is that they believe there can be reprisals if there are demonstrations, anti-Israeli demonstrations in Ramallah.
What it has to do with water, I don't know.
Well, they see Ofra sitting on their main pipeline. They see an army camp built around their main reservoir, and they believe that that is political pressure.
I'm working here for since 67. And the only time which we break our rules, it was when we closed the water for a certain village because they didn't pay for 6 months or even more. We never close the water to somebody or to any customer because of any other reason.
Israelis ask why Arabs see the supply of water not as a benefit, but as a limit to their future independence. Ramallah, they say, can choose to do without Israeli water when and if some form of Palestinian autonomy for the West Bank is agreed.
There are, between two countries, there are always arrangements of water. Now, with the fact that they have now water from Israel, it doesn't mean that later on they won't be able to utilize another sources. Other sources. For the time being, this was the cheapest and the fastest way to bring water to the people of Ramallah. And thanks God we did it in time.
But they believe that the Israelis don't seriously want a peace, and that this is all part of a process of integrating the West Bank into Israel, to integrate the water supply.
Let me not comment to it, please.
The West Bank Palestinians have seen what Israel's control of their water has meant. They distrust Israeli talk of autonomy, believing that however it's wrapped up, Israel will continue to govern their security, their land, and their water. Almost no Israeli politician is willing to leave control of the West Bank's water in Arab hands. Palestinians see autonomy as only a slight change from occupation, perhaps even a change for the worse.
Palestinians are afraid that the forms of autonomy and self-government that are being proposed now by the Israelis are not genuine, that they are merely a way to legalize the present system of continued occupation and continued dependence on Israel. So that if there is going to be true independence one day, then Palestinians need to obtain control of their own land, their own water resources, to build their own infrastructure, to have their own industry, etc., etc.
An infrastructure is being built on the West Bank, but it's Jewish, not Arab. The weeks before the Israeli election were marked by a flurry of construction, laying down the outlines of new settlements to deter any new government from disturbing created facts. As thousands more settlers move in, they reinforce Israeli claims to sovereignty over the West Bank and its water.
In the land of Israel, there is one boss, there is one sovereign, and there will be one kingdom, the Jewish kingdom. All other people are more than welcome to take part in the life that is here. But ruler, there will be one.
Whose land are you living on?
In my eyes, I'm living on the Jewish land, on the land of Israel.
Even though at the moment 98% of the population is Arab in this area?
Yes, I think the percentage of population or whoever lives here now or will ever live here doesn't change the basic historic fact that this place here is the birthplace of the Jewish nation. It has always belonged to the Jewish nation and it always will be.
Could you imagine an autonomous Palestinian state having control of the water supply in this area?
You have to ask me a more basic question. Could I imagine a Palestinian political entity in general?
Could you?
No.
As the settlements take root, they underline Israel's need to control the West Bank's water. No Israeli government dare risk the settlers being cut off after autonomy. Just as no Israeli government dare risk its own water supplies being affected by Arab drilling. The most that autonomy offers the Palestinians is joint control of their water, whether they like it or not.
I do not think that we can allow, neither they, that the question of controlling, managing water resources can be separated between the two nations, between the two societies. It must be managed together. We cannot give up control, neither they.
Israel, of course, already has control and will keep it. In the Six-Day War, along with the West Bank, the Golan Heights were captured. Their strategic position threatening Israel is well known. But also in the Golan is one of the main sources of the River Jordan, making Israel master of all the waters between the Jordan and the Mediterranean. Israel has 70% of the region's population, but takes 85% of the available water.
Israel is based on these quantities since the last 20 years or more than that. Reducing these quantities means a reduction of the Israeli map. And this is not acceptable.
The Israelis say that at the moment they use 85% of the available water resources between the Mediterranean and the Jordan, and they can't afford to use any less. There simply isn't room for more water for the Palestinians.
Well, that is the same as saying there is no room for the Palestinians on their own land. That is really the quintessential issue. At this point, Palestinians have felt from the very beginning, from 1948, that the goal of Zionism was to obtain this land without its people for the Jewish people who had no land. In other words, they see Zionism as attempting to displace all Arabs and to replace them with Jews. And the statement you just made, that they need the water, that there is no room for them to give water to us, is the same as saying they don't want us here.
In the West Bank, it is Israel's hand on the tap which maintains the status quo, a division of water which Arabs see as delaying their development, limiting their future, leaving them forever in second place.